And welcome to this week's serving of Mickey Waffles, a Disney podcast where we cover everything from parks, movies, and merchandise. My name is Sinead.
My name's Kate. Hi, guys. How's it going?
I'm good, Kate. How are you?
I'm good, Sinead. You know what today is?
It's Tuesday.
And you know what that means. It's Special Guest Tuesday.
Woo! We have two guests.
Yeah. Haven't done for a while, and then bam, two come at once.
So this week we are joined by the lovely Sandy, aka Glotini Genie, aka Glitter and Bows.
And my co-host on Christmas Crackers, Sam.
Oh, Kate, you have to do the dots.
Also known as the dot girl dot in dot the dot castle.
There we go.
Nice.
Thank you.
All the dots. Ladies, how are we?
Good.
Good.
I'm so afraid we're going to talk over each other the whole time.
No, I'm sure it'll be fine.
It's fine.
Everyone just take half a second breath before they talk.
Yeah. Good Zoom etiquette. So, Sam, I feel like it's been the longest since we've had you on. So, how have you been?
That's true.
How's life?
I'm fine. Yeah. Not been up to much because, you know, the old pandemic. So.
How's Cork?
Cork's good, yeah. It's doing well. Not got many cases lately, so that's good.
Well, that's good. That's good. I didn't actually know that.
Oh, yeah, no. Cork averages now between, like, 10 and 20 a day.
Which... That's really good, considering how big of a county you are.
Mm-hmm. And considering how many protests Cork has, which is ridiculous.
Oh, my God.
No, sorry.
Not a visual medium, but Sam really just did a full-blown, like, sorry, yeah, no, sorry. Did you just hear the Cork great, like, pushing her hair behind her ear? Oh, my God, it was gas.
No, I got my hair cut, and now it's really annoying me because I'm not used to having a little bitty piece here. And I don't like it.
Okay.
But, so I apologize.
Gotcha.
That was not meant as sassiness of Cork is great, so Cork is wonderful.
Brilliant. And how are you, Sandy?
I'm very good. The world's opening back up again. It's great.
I know. It's exciting times. For context, I got to see Sandy yesterday. We went to Bray. It was great. We had ice cream for dinner. Wonderful.
Fantastic. Chips for dessert.
Yeah. Oh my God, nice. Chips backwards. Were love outrageous. We hadn't planned on getting chips, but then Amy hadn't eaten because we did the good thing and got the ice cream before the lactose intolerant person arrived.
Hey.
Because I didn't want to make her feel bad.
Yeah, that's fair.
So
she'd be tooting all the way home.
Yeah, exactly. And that was not good for anybody. Amy's gonna be real happy when she listens to this.
She loves us. I went into Arnott's today.
You did.
Now, I didn't go very far. I went down to Gap and came back up. But
booked an appointment. How was the booking appointment?
Oh, really easy. I Googled Arnott's booking. That's all I had to Google. And it came up first try. And it was like, when would you like to book? And I could book morning, evening, or afternoon.
Cool.
And I wanted the morning. And it was 10 to 11. And I could have a booking for 11 or half 11 or 12.
Sweet.
And then it turned to afternoon. There was three bookings left for half 11. So
that's fantastic.
At 10 to 11. Because I was on the other side. I was south side. So I had to get across the river. So I was like, oh, I'm not going to make it there by 11. But I don't need to be there. I was like, I don't need the 12 one either. So I booked the half 11. Hopped on literally any bus. Because they're all going the same direction from there. And yeah, it was grand. Just went up. It went up. Now, while I was on the bus... I was obviously outside of a Penny's because I was going up O'Connell Street.
Oh yeah.
And I think so when they were letting people in, they were barely looking at people's phones. So I think if you had a booking,
we're going to cause riots.
I think you could screenshot it and send it to your friend and just have them be down the queue a bit because they don't like scan it. They don't like have like, so like in Arnott's, there was a lady with an iPad and she was like, oh, what's the name? I was like, okay, Privet. And she was like, that's fine. And you go. And I think she did something with my name afterwards. But in Penny's, they don't have any of that. It's just people being like, yeah, go on, go on, go on. And like barely glancing at the phone. So I think if they see like the Penny's logo, like you're in there. That's just from observation. Now,
interesting.
I wouldn't.
All the life hacks.
I'm just saying, I think that might work. Just.
I did see a TikTok earlier on where a girl.
Oh,
did you see this?
No, go on.
A girl had borrowed her friend who works in Penny's, had borrowed her work top and just strolled on in the door like an employee and bought loads of crap.
That's
genius.
Wild. Ooh.
Sneaky, sneaky.
Now, see, now. Ooh. All right, Sam.
Sorry. I'm just like, wow, like that is mad. The confidence you'd have to have.
Oh, yeah.
I'd be so stressed.
You'd have to be swanning in there like you own the place. Because what if you tried to walk in the main door and then they sent you in through like a staff door?
Yeah, they would be like, this isn't where you come in.
Fuck, where do I go now?
Yeah, I'm like, I heard that Penny's can, I heard that Penny's are either super strict or super lax.
That doesn't surprise me.
And like, what if like, I don't know, I suppose her friend was like, this is what you do, just walk in kind of thing, maybe. But yeah. I haven't tested it and I won't be testing it, but sure luck.
You know how in the on the Disney clothes they have a cute little like Disney tag a lot of the time of like the character or something. One time I was in Penny's and one was on the floor not attached to anything and I was like, oh, I'll take that for my scrapbook, and then I was afraid that that would go off.
The story I've ever heard in my entire life.
You were afraid that what?
I was afraid that if I like left Penny's, the like alarms would go off and then I'd have to explain that I stole a tag, like not even close.
You think Penny's security tag things?
Well, there's no beepers in Penny's.
I wasn't willing to risk it. I was afraid I'd have to like
this
tell
really
the whole
story.
This
really is the most Sam story I've ever heard.
Especially in a Penny's in Cork. Like I found, you know, my favourite
thing. What are you trying
to say about Cork, Kate? No.
Very trusting.
No, yeah, sorry. No, I meant it in the completely opposite way. In that any Penny's I've been to outside of Dublin, so lovely. It's like a completely different world. Everyone's so pleasant. They always have really nice discounted things. They always have like really nice jumper. I don't know. It's just like the vibe's always completely different. But the Penny's
clearly not being too loud.
No, I haven't.
The Dundrum and Mary Street ones, though, you take your life in your hands.
Yeah, but I mean, like, I'm talking about like Cork and Galway and like those kind of ones where they're very like, it's like, only like old ladies work in them.
Welcome home.
It's like in Penny's in Dublin, it's all college students. But in like the country, don't hate me, but you know what I mean. It's all like old little biddies. And they're all just like moving at like a nice slow pace. And everyone in town is like throwing leggings at the wall.
Only ever had a nice shopping experience in the same is. Is it Mary Street? I actually don't know.
Mary Street's the big one.
Mary
the first
Street's
one.
The big one.
Yeah.
That's the one.
The OG.
That's the one.
Yep.
From 1969.
Hi, hello. Welcome to Penny's Talk. If you've been to Penny's.
We only know that because Gap and Penny's started in the same year.
Fair.
Yep.
Fair. There you go.
So that's all I have. It was. Oh, yeah. My Arnott's experience was lovely. Thank you.
Oh, good. I'm glad. How's the rest of your week been?
Yeah, it's been fine. Not really been up to a whole lot. We got a new shower head for our shower.
Ooh.
Because it only had plus 1,000 degrees as the temperature. And so we thought it was because of the shower head, because it wasn't getting enough water pressure. So we bought a new shower head. And now I can have a shower without turning into a tomato. So that's good. What else? We finished Shadow and Bone.
Oh, very nice.
Yeah, Ed was very committed. all the way through it, he was like, oh, they're going to do this now. And I was like, interesting that you're intrigued. yeah, other than that, nothing really. It's been quite a nonchalant week. Not really been doing much. Huh?
Yeah. I said nonchalant week. I like it.
Oh, sorry. I could.
I also had no audio there, and I was like,
my
bad.
Zoom let us down there for a sec. yeah, but like, look, sure. Next week, everything's hopping off.
Ooh.
I'm going to be way busy next week, so I'll enjoy my peace while I have it.
That's fair. That sounds nice.
Thank you. What about you, Ethan? Apart from meeting Sandy in the beach.
Yeah, went to the beach, had ice cream for dinner. It was lovely. I, for context, not that anybody asked, I got a scoop of Kinder Bueno, a scoop of Black Forest, and a scoop of honeycomb. And it was
where
delightful.
Did you get the ice cream from?
Gino's on Bray Seafront.
I didn't know there was a Gino's on Bray Seafront.
Mm. I had forgot there was, and then I remembered, and I was like, Sandy will be bloody delighted. And what was Sandy? Bloody delighted.
Do you really like Gino's?
I love Gino's. Oh, we used to have one by our staff entrance at work, uh-huh. And like in the evening, you just smell the melted chocolate.
Mm.
Oh, yeah.
Nice.
It was great.
Good time. It was a good time. Mm-hmm. Other than that, I mean, I watched The Goonies for the first time at the weekend. Bloody loved it. Don't know how I've made it this far in my life. Never seen The Goonies. Really enjoyed it. And also watched The Lord of the Rings and may have mildly fell asleep during it, but I did enjoy it. So the plan is to watch the second one, I think, this weekend.
Oh, the amount of times Ed is like, we should watch Lord of the Rings. And I'm like, we should not.
I really enjoyed it. And I had, like, I've definitely seen the first two because I distinctly remember when I was in primary school going to the Ormond Cinema in Greystones and watching The Two Towers because the Ormond Cinema used to, if a movie was over a certain length of time, I think if it was more than 2 hours, they'd take a break. They'd like pause the movie. Excellent. And let people go out to like the bathroom or for a smoke because it was back in the early 2000s. Or like go and get more sweets and stuff. So I distinctly remember them pausing the movie and being like, you have 10 minutes. And then came back and they started it again. And it was great.
Mm, I do think I'd enjoy them more if we paused them halfway through and took like a break. They're right. They're just too long.
Yeah, I think that was the thing. I was just a bit sleepy.
I know they're great movies. Like, I know that in like deep down, I know. And like, I do find them quite interesting, but they're just that little bit too long that I'm like, is this not yet over? This trek is taking them so long.
Yeah, we were trying to find it online and the only place that we could download it was from, I think, YouTube. And it was like, you can have the regular one or the extended one. And yeah, mercifully, we didn't watch the extended one because I don't think I would have made it through 4 hours.
I watched the extended one in Amy's house and I think I almost fell asleep. But to be fair, we also watched it quite late. And I was like, is this nearly over? And she was like, yeah, it's not got long left. It had at least an hour left.
Sneaky.
Full on lied to me.
Sneaky. Amy was very excited though when I told her that I watched Lord of the Rings. She was like, tell me everything, I want an in-depth review. And I was like, okay. So that was fun. Yeah, that was about as exciting as my week has been.
Great. Cool.
Yeah.
Fab. We're not doing news this week because there's not really that much news. There was a couple of doodads, but like,
yeah, a couple of doodads. We'll talk about them next week.
Nothing
company next week.
Yeah. Nothing exciting enough to waste our words on. I suppose we'll get on to why we've brought you here today.
is this an intervention?
So
I'm getting slightly concerned.
I think we all love Disney that little bit too much, to the point where it's now inhibiting on our lives. So I think we need to all take a step back.
True story. So we mentioned on the podcast last week that Craig from Disney Parks and Beyond and 10 million other podcasts on the After Podcast Network had made the suggestion of doing an episode about solo traveling to Disney from a women's perspective. And whilst I haven't traveled to DLP by myself, I have done days in the parks by myself. And Kate did a day in Tokyo Disney Sea by yourself as well. I'm pointing like this because Kate's underneath me on the Zoom and I keep pointing down because I'm like, there she is.
You're beside me. I'm like, why are you pointing to Sandy?
On my screen, I was pointing to you. So we decided to loop in Sandy and Sam because y'all have done solo trips to Disney. Well, DLP specifically.
Yeah.
Yes, we have.
Fab. So where do we want to start? We've done no prep for this. Where do we want to start?
What made you guys want to go on trips by yourselves?
Ooh.
I think that's a good starting point, and then we'll probably trickle from there.
Cool. Sandy, you're first on my screen. Do you want to go first?
Yeah, someone else.
I was like, who's going to take it?
I went in 2017 and 2019, and both reasons were actually fairly similar. In 2017, it was February, and I wanted to go and say goodbye to dreams. And I know, like,
he's still not R.I.P. Moment of silence. Moment of silence for dreams.
Dreams.
Yeah. And honestly, like, is this a bit too much to share in a podcast? Who knows? But the person I was with at the time was just a bit of a head wrecker and was no fun and really was a bit of a drain on any of those Disney tricks. So I was like, hey.
Know that feeling.
Reset.
Let's go on your own. So yeah. And then 2019, same reason. I wanted to see Pirates and Princesses because it had come out. It wasn't coming back. So
I just... Sorry, we've lost Kate.
Oh, that just hit me hard.
Too Darky. Relatable.
Yeah.
Oh, God.
I'm sorry, continue.
Yeah, 2019 was the same. I wanted to say goodbye to something that wasn't coming back. So I just done a quick trip in 2019 to see Pirates and Princesses again. And that was it.
I never saw Pirates and Princesses and I'm pissed off about it. Just want to put
it
that out.
It was great.
I'm so annoyed. I'm like, the Lion King and Jungle thing is like grand, whatever. But like, I'm pissed that they got rid of it.
Yeah, same. The song.
I thought I had seen Pirates and Princesses, but I don't think I have because I'm sure that came back in 2020 when I was there again. So maybe not.
Was that before your COVID trip? Was that your COVID trip?
So they both technically were close.
They were bringing out like special things for those ones.
Yeah.
I'd like to retract my statement. Kate's okay. Right. Yeah. No, okay. It was 2019 Princess versus Pirates. That was Frozen, but they brought back the parade float.
I was about to say, like, you probably saw the float and the flower
and the
dresses,
music and stuff.
But that's why.
Yeah. That's it. That's why.
Brilliant.
Retract my statement.
So Sam, why did you want to do a solo trip?
So I had initially gone in 2017 with my mammy, and that was a great trip, but I really wanted to go again, and I was so sick of all my friends being like, yeah, let's book together. Oh, not this time, I can't really afford it, and oh, I can't get the week off work. And I was like, I'm free all the time and I want to go now. So I just decided to stop waiting for everybody else and go by myself. So
that's a great reason.
Thanks. I just got sick. I'm too impatient for other people. Like, I'll do it on my own. So I did.
Did you guys have like agenda set out before you were gonna go? Like, did you? So like, as knowing that you were gonna go by yourself, you obviously don't have to talk to anyone else about what your plans are. So did you still make plans, or did you, like, I'm talking like, not necessarily just in the park, but from like getting to your house, like from front door to hotel door, did you have like anything in place that you maybe wouldn't have had before if you were traveling in a group, or if there was anything you thought about being like, oh, now that I'm traveling alone, I should probably think about this or anything like that?
The only thing that I'm like looking at Sandy like, you want to go? So for me, I'm a big planner and I would plan anyway, regardless. And I, regardless of who I'm traveling with in a group, normally, unless I get a trip with Sinead, normally I'm in charge of planning everything.
Virgo life.
And so I would always take that anyway. The only thing that I knew or that I wanted to put in place for myself was that I didn't want to have to deal with too much public transport. So I just booked a transfer company to take me from airport to hotel so that I wouldn't have to navigate trains or buses or any of that, even though I knew it would work out cheaper and it would be more expensive as a solo traveler to get the cab. I just, for my own personal anxiety, was like, that's what I'm going to do.
Is that specifically because you were traveling by yourself or just out of these anyway?
Yeah, no, I think if it was a case of like I was going with a group, I'd be more confident in kind of being willing to navigate those a bit more.
Mm-hmm.
But I wouldn't feel comfortable, particularly when I haven't done it before. I think if I had done it once, Maybe, but I've never gotten trains or anything like that, even though they're cheaper. So
that's so interesting you say that, because I done the exact opposite for the same reason, which is so funny. Because I didn't feel comfortable on my first solo trip being in a car with just one driver. On my own, and he could turn off anywhere. I felt really unsafe with that. So my first trip, I got the Magical Express. Because my first trip was on-site. My second trip was off-site. So my off-site one, I didn't really plan. That was all willy-nilly. But my first one, I didn't get a private shuttle purely because I wanted to be surrounded by people for safety. Which is so,
so interesting.
That is. I had taken the cab before, and I think because I had two trips to Paris prior to my solo trips, I was fairly certain I knew the route that if they turned off,
right,
I'd know something was sus. I did on my second solo trip. When I booked with Prestige, there was a man waiting at the gate with my name on a board, and he took my bag and he walked me to the car. And when I got in, it was a different man driving. I was like, where'd the guy go?
Oh, good.
I fully thought I had sat into the wrong car. I was like, oh dear, this has all gone wrong. And so what I did is I updated my Instagram story to be en route, so that if I didn't then in 45 minutes be I've arrived, someone would alert someone.
Oh my god.
But it turned out that man was just there to walk people.
I'd imagine so. Yeah,
it wasn't anything sinister. It's not like he saw me updating Instagram and was like, oh, I won't kidnap this one. She's too clever for me.
That's so funny. And Kate, when you were in Japan, was there anything, because obviously that was wildly different, how did you kind of go about getting yourself out to Disney?
So the thing in Japan was that we had no internet on our phones, apart from when we had Wi-Fi, because we didn't. When you get to Japan, you can buy these little Wi-Fi hubs for travelers. They're they sell them in vending machines and stuff, where you spend 30 quid and it's enough Wi-Fi. It gives you how many gigs of Wi-Fi every day kind of thing. And we decided that we just didn't need it, because I guess the whole point was to enjoy being in Japan. So we were realistically, the only thing we need our phones for is to get around. But if you Googled your route beforehand on Google Maps, when you're in Wi-Fi, you can download that onto your phone, and it'll show you the route. Obviously, it doesn't track you properly, but it gives you enough to show you where you need to go. And this is at our end of our trip. So I'd had a week and a half of Japanese transport, and I was, looking back, I can't believe I did it, because I think if I tried to do this now, I wouldn't. And okay. I don't know why. I'm obviously more anxious than I used to be. But so it was actually our last day. So we were flying home that day. And so I had to pack up my two suitcases, bring them to the main train station, put them in these lockers, which I had to get Jared to show me how they worked the day before, because I was like, these are all in Japanese. So I set off out of the hotel. Went to the metro, got on the metro by myself, went to the main train station, dropped off my bags into these Japanese lockers that sung a little song at me, then hopped on another metro that I'd never been on before, because we'd never traveled that direction, and somehow managed to get to Disney. But when you get to Disney, it drops you off at Disneyland, and you have to get an internal tram to Disney Sea. And I didn't know this, but you have to pay for it. It's not free, the monorail. I had barely any Japanese money left. I was lucky I had a couple of hundred yen to pay for the ticket, because there was only change options. And I was like, I don't, no one told me, the only option people kept telling me was the monorail. And I was like, I can walk. Can someone tell me to walk? They were like, no, the train. And I'm like, I don't want that. 300 yen, I barely have that. so that was that. But then once I got there, it was fine, because I think whenever you get into a Disney park, you kind of immediately feel safe, regardless of where it is. And you know that especially in Japan, like, everyone is so polite, everyone is so nice. I actually think I had two or three people come up to me and ask me, did I need help? Because I obviously looked so lost. But once I got there, yeah, I had absolutely no plan. But yeah, I don't know. It was kind of like, it was more like situational. It was like, this is probably my only chance to go to Tokyo Disney in a while. So even though I have to go by myself, I'm going. And I think that like headstrong part of me obviously overtook my, oh my God, I have to navigate Japanese transport by myself for a whole day.
Yeah.
But yeah, like once I got in the park, I think it was I think it was okay. Especially like, I feel like in Japan as well, it's like an extra bit of safety. Like I never was like, oh, someone might kidnap me or do this or do that, because it just doesn't happen.
No, that's fair. That's fair. The only kind of time I've, see, it's weird. I've traveled to DLP by myself, but then crashed Kate's family holiday. so it wasn't really a solo trip. I just had to get there by myself, but I travel a lot for work anyway. So like getting on a plane by myself in the last few years, I mean, not in the last year, but before that, like I would have to do it at least once a month anyway. So I kind of like, I feel like I know Dublin Airport like the back of my hand. I always try book my seat and I try to sit in the same place because I'm an absolute creature of habit. So like getting there was fine. And like, obviously I've done the trip to DLP a couple times before. I opted to get the magical shuttle because that was what I knew how to do. So I knew where you come out from an Aer Lingus flight, where you go to get it. Not hilariously, but I have never encountered them myself, but you get those like really aggressive taxi drivers when you're waiting for the magical shuttle sometimes.
So scary.
And they're really terrifying. Now, they completely ignored me, but they like were latching onto this family and trying to get this family to spend €120 to get from Charles de Gaulle to Disneyland Paris. And the mum and dad clearly had never been before and they were kind of contemplating it. And I just kind of like, they had been on my flight and I just kind of leaned over to your one and I was like, the bus will be here in 10 minutes and it's like it's like €15 each. And she was like, oh, okay. And at that moment I was a little bit terrified because that taxi driver looked like he wanted to shiv me, because I was like, okay. So I like, if you've never gotten the magical shuttle, there is like a little like office-y thing that you can wait in. Now normally I would just stand outside, but your man was genuinely looked like he wanted to like fucking castrate me or something like that. So I was like, am I going to stand in the little office thing? And I think I remember sending Kate a message being like, I think I just really pissed off the taxi driver, but I saved an old family, so.
And I was like, what?
But yeah. And but on the way back, I got the train, and I don't like getting the train back to Charles de Gaulle. It just confuses me. I know it only takes 10 minutes, but I fucking hate it. And I got the train back that time, and because I think the buses were just arseways or something like that. And I had a really short, I think I literally only had extra magic time and then I had to leave. And it just, the trains just stress me out around DLP. I just can't cope with them.
I don't get them.
And the staff are so rude and unhelpful. And I don't speak a tap of French. And is that my own ignorance? Yes, but still.
But like, they're, I don't think I've ever, now this isn't even on the French, like, well, not the French as a whole, but I've never been to any sort of like clearly like tourist destination. And like, even though we're not in Disney when you're in the train station, you're at a pretty prominent tourist destination.
Got your ears on, they should know.
I have never encountered such rude staff that do not want to help you in any way. And I'm like, regardless of the fact that I don't speak your language, you understand what I need.
Yeah.
And you're like, they're like, no, and I'm like, that's fine, but we could figure it out. And but they like put their hand in your face and they just walk away. And I'm like,
yeah, I'm
about to cry.
Like, literally, I was trying to figure out what platform it was, because there were two trains that basically said the same thing. And I was like, I don't know which platform I'm supposed to go to. So I literally pointed out my ticket and was like, platform, like, where am I? And I even think I googled the word platform on my phone to have it in French. And your man just kind of went and walked off. I was like, okay, cool, great. Now, I managed to get the train in the end, but I was like, this is the last time I get the train. I was like, I don't care for the train. I will get the bus, or I will get a car, because fuck that.
I did look up some vlogs when I was booking my trip to see would it be worth getting the train. So I watched some like very specific, like how to get from Charles de Gaulle to Disney via the RE or whatever they call it. And there was some really helpful ones, but overall I was like, it's just too complicated. And the last thing I want to be is stressed.
I think that's the problem, is that as well, like once you're on a train, it's very difficult to be like, shit, I need to get off. Like if you miss your stop, the next stop might not be for another half an hour.
Yeah.
But when you're on a bus, the driver's right there. So you can be like, if something does happen and you're like, shit, you can be like, oh, I'm really sorry. Can we really stop? I'm so sorry, blah, blah, blah. But like on a train, those fuckers are going. Like there's no stopping them. Do you know what I mean? So it's like, it's scary. Like obviously trains in general aren't scary, but like that particular train, and because it's so time sensitive with like your flight and everything, and it's like, I've had one experience in my life, almost missing an airplane. And I am never going through that again because I thought I was going to die. Going forward in life, never again will I not have at least 4 hours between me arriving at the airport and the plane leaving.
That was I can't even remember where you were, but I was like looking up flights for like, were you in London or something?
We were in London, yeah.
Oh my god, it was horrific. I was like, how are we going to get Kate home?
I don't know.
The London airports are much longer than you expect, though. That's the problem.
We wanted to get the Gatwick Express or whatever that red train is, and for some reason I listened to Ed like an idiot, and he was like, we don't have to get the train until this time. And for some reason in my head, I was like, yeah, you're right. That'll leave us loads of time.
For context, Ed is one of those people that would quite happily rock up to the airport 5 seconds before the flight. He does not like the airport.
No, he doesn't like flying. So he's like, we don't need to be there so early. And I'm like, oh, how wrong you are. So we ended up, but then the problem was we didn't get the express one because that line wasn't running or something, or we'd missed it, or they weren't actually on the timetable. So we had to get another one. That was one of the ones that stops at all the stations. And then there was a problem on the line. And then I was like, okay, well, our flight leaves in 45 minutes. How have we done this? And he was like, it'll be fine, don't worry. And we were stuck at that station for a good like 20 minutes. And I was like, okay, so are we rebooking flights or what's going on? Because we're not getting on these ones. And so we got off the train, got in a taxi. Don't know how we managed to get a taxi. And because it turned out we weren't that far from the airport, but the train wasn't moving.
I would be crying at this point.
I basically was.
I was looking up every other flight alternative and how to get to the various other airports to try and get them home. I was like, let me plan this case.
We got to the airport, ran. Ed negotiated with every single person in the security queue. I was nearly like, I'd say looking at me was like, oh shit, yeah, you can go. Because I was like,
dying.
Oh no.
He was like, we're so sorry. Would you mind if we just skipped ahead of you, blah, blah, blah. And every single person was like, yeah.
I'm feeling it in my heart.
Single person was like, absolutely, go, move. Apart from the security person at the conveyor belt. And they were like, you're not next. And we were like, oh, it's okay. They said we could skip. And they're like, they were like, I don't care if they said, you're not next. And I was like, I was like, please let me, please.
Me in London. London people are rude.
I was like, please check my bag. I need to leave. And then we ran. I don't run. We ran to the gate. And sure, didn't we get to the gate? They weren't even boarding. We stood in the line for a good 15 minutes, 20 minutes before we even touched the lady.
Ed being like, told you we'd be fine.
No, because he still wouldn't have. We needed to get off. But that is the last time I ever listened to him.
I remember when I was in the queue for Heathrow, there was this couple, maybe it was you and I didn't know you at the time, but there was this couple who were like, please can we go? I was like, yes, of course. And the woman was like, no, get back. And I was like, no, they can go. Like, every single person was like, uh-huh. Maybe it was you. Imagine maybe if it was. That would be so funny.
That was so funny.
And the thing was as well, I borrowed, this was the bit I felt so bad about, and it didn't matter. I was working at Disney at the time, and one of the girls I worked with, she had like a spare Oyster card from the last time she was in London, and she'd said, you can use my Oyster card, because like, it's fine, just give it back to me when you get back. And I was like, yeah, no problem. While rushing to get my boarding pass out, I dropped her Oyster card. Oh, I dropped a bunch of cards, just like reaming it out of my pocket, but one woman had like picked them up and been like, sorry, I think these are yours. And I was like, oh, grand, thanks. Which turned out to be like my debit card, I think my Leap card for some reason, but obviously the Oyster card got left on the ground. And so when I got back to Dublin, I was like, oh shit. And so I went to her and I was like, I'm so sorry. She was like, ah, it's fine. But I was like
they're like £5, I'm sorry, she can pick it up next time.
You don't need that anymore, you can use your debit card. I was like, I'm so blah, blah, blah. She was like, honestly, it's fine. And I was like, are you sure?
Oh, God.
So, yeah, after that tangent. Yeah, so if I can disclose any advice to anybody, it's that the 2 hours before the airport really is needed. Important. So one does not die of a heart attack.
It's good mooching and drinking time.
Why be stressed about will I get there or won't I, when you could just be there and do other things? Like,
yeah,
just be there and read or drink or go eat chocolate or go
do
have
all
a
of
coffee.
That.
Do ever, like, do you know what I mean? Go buy magazines you would never normally buy. Like, there's just, it's all part of the experience. You're missing out.
Yeah.
There you go. Yeah.
See, so, I don't know what we were talking about.
We were talking about traveling.
There's a tangent about transport. So when it comes to actually like structuring your like days in the parks, and again, I'm aware I'm talking to a group of planners. I'm very aware of that. So like, how would you go about structuring your day, or what did you prioritize that, or how did you just kind of like run your days versus if you were there with other people? Whichever of you wants to go first.
Well, I suppose we'll go with the 2017 trip, because that was like my first solo trip. Mm-hmm. And that was when I turned into a different woman. It's fantastic. It was very, very life-changing.
Jesus. Someone's going to a different Disneyland than I'm going to.
Don't color glow teeny genie for nothing.
As I had previously mentioned, the person that I was previously with at the time was just a dry shite. So, and he didn't like food. And if we know me, I bloody love food. So my entire trip, my entire 5 days, was based around restaurants. So it was fantastic.
Brilliant.
So like, I think that, I don't know whether you agree, Sam, but like the park bit is the most safest bit. That's the bit that feels like home. So I was never really worried about the park bit. It was the outside bits that I was a bit niggly about. But I booked restaurants, and because I wanted to get all the restaurants in that I hadn't previously eaten at, I mean, I booked my breakfast, I booked my lunch, and I booked my dinner for every day, so I could hit all the restaurants I wanted to before I went home. So that's how my days were planned. And I mean, I ate good that week. I came home so much heavier, but it was fantastic. And I was ordering bottles of wine with my dinner. It wasn't a glass, because there was no one there to tell me otherwise. It was fantastic. I could go on whatever rides I wanted. I could eat and drink as much as I wanted. I could pee when I wanted. I didn't have to answer to anybody. It was fantastic. I love it.
I would just like to put out there, if anyone ever goes on a group trip with me, I will also be peeing whenever I want. No one will be dictating.
No, with
when.
Me, you won't. I've got a skin it. No,
Sam, we have seen your plan. I wouldn't put it past you.
Sam's like, you can pee between 12 and 12:05. Other than that, your next slot is 3:10 and 3:15. Otherwise, we are not near any more toilets until dinner. So plan your drinks.
But there's nothing worse than, you know, like when you see, say, like Big Thunder, and it's suddenly down to only 20 minutes. And then the person you're with is like, yeah, I'm going to the toilet. I'm like, yeah, but by the time you come back, this could be fucking 60 minutes. Like, can you hold it? Like, yeah, that kind of thing. So,
no, no, to be fair, I never get like that with if somebody needs to pee. Because if somebody needs to pee, somebody needs to pee. It is what it is. True. Smokers.
Ah, yes.
When I went with a fucking smoker, it was like, oh, can I just stop off here for 5 minutes? And I'm like,
and there's only designated parts as well, so you really got to go out of your way.
Yeah, yeah, you do, you do. And it was either a case of like, okay, well, I'm gonna go do something else, or cool, so I'm also expected to stand in this area and end up just smelling of smoke.
Great. Oh, it was vile,
horrific.
It wasn't nice. So,
yeah, no, would not recommend. Would not recommend. Sam, how about you? Because I know you plan your trips to within an inch of their life.
Yeah. Almost the exact opposite of Sandy. Could not give a shit about food. I'm not there to eat. I have food at home. I will I will eat after Disney. I actually lose weight when I go to Disney. It's the complete opposite. My last trip, I love that we brought
you guys on, and you are just the polar opposite of everything to each other.
Don't go to Disneyland to eat. We've got plenty of food in Cork.
What are you going to offer me that my mammy hasn't cooked me? You know? Nah.
Don't be eating for a good 4 days. Like, I stock up before
like
I leave.
Camel. You just like,
I genuinely could not care less about the food. So that doesn't really factor into
unless
it.
Unless there's a character.
At all. Exactly. Personally as well, the one thing I was slightly nervous about was eating in restaurants. I didn't want to eat in any of the fancy like table service on my own. For some reason that felt weird to me.
Bring a book.
Yeah, I just thought people would be looking at me. I don't know why.
No one gives a shit.
No, they definitely don't. And I teased a little bit in with a bit of character dining. I tested a little bit. Now I think I would completely do it.
Wait,
but I was initially
sorry. You teased what?
Like eating on my own. In posture
places.
Oh,
I thought you meant reading a book. I was I brought a leaflet to start with.
Coming up and I'm like...
But just when you were saying that, like...
this chapter.
Just when you were saying that you did the character dining by yourself, it just brought me back to that episode that we did with Andrea about Castle Club, when every second sentence was, because I was by myself.
Andrea. So I don't really, food doesn't factor into it a whole pile. Usually what I'll tend to do is I will look at the program of previous weeks, because normally they don't change too much on a weekly basis. So I will look at the past kind of 2 weeks programs and I will make my list from there of like characters I want to meet, shows I want to see. And when I say make a list, I don't mean like, oh, Tuesday, maybe we'll see Mickey and the Mission. I mean like 8 o'clock, 7 o'clock. We're like, I will fully like have it all planned. I'm not anal about it. I will flex off the plan if I see. Kate looks so skeptical. I will. You know, if a surprise character pops up, I'm not like, nope, we're seeing Goofy. Like I can change it, but I like to have a plan. Because the only day I ever went without a plan was the worst day in Disney I've ever had. It was so chaotic and I was not here for it.
What happened?
I arrived and everything was, there were so many people, way more than had ever been at Disney. And I was like, where do I go? The queues are crazy. I just need to do something so that I feel productive, because I was just wasting. I wasted a good hour just walking from various queues.
And not picking something.
Yeah, and not picking something. And so in the end, I like, because it was the shortest queue, I got on the story boats.
Oh, yeah.
It's like, this was the worst mistake.
Oh, I love it.
Because I was just sat there for 10 minutes going around like,
and then have that traumatic experience of trying to get back off them.
Yeah. Oh, I always find that quite fun.
Oh, when it looks like the stairs are spinning.
I do feel like that's something that we sort of like self-sabotage ourselves with as people who have the opportunity to be able to go at quiet times. If we end up accidentally going on a day where it's busy, it's like, fuck, what do I do?
It's really overwhelming.
Like, because you've been on everything in your past life, you're like, well, I'm not waiting an hour and a half for it. But then when everything's an hour and a half away, you're like, well, I got to do something.
Mm. There's a solution to that. Sit at Victoria's and drink champagne. And just sit there.
See,
and enjoy.
Now, get a waffle.
That just seems like a waste of time.
I am already bored at that idea.
Oh, I love sitting on the street.
Like, I don't mind sitting down. These stories get me worried about if we ever go on an actual group trip. I feel like not clashing, because we won't clash or like argue, but I feel like there'll be a lot of like,
but like, I think we're all independent enough that we'll all just quite happily like split off and do whatever.
Yeah,
that's true.
Yeah.
So how did you go about navigating or like planning your day in Tokyo, Kate?
Oh, I didn't. I knew that I had to be gone by a certain time so that I could meet Jer in the train station, because we were going to get the same train back to the airport. Because I was like, you have to wait for me. I was like, I cannot get to the airport by myself. And he was like, yeah. I was like, the reason I came with you is because you can speak Japanese. I was like, that was the whole point. You were my safety net. So you can't leave without me. He was like, no, I won't. So I knew I had to be gone by a certain time. So I just sort of went in. Now, looking back, I did not use my time to my advantage. I really wanted to go on Midway Mania because I didn't realize there was one in DisneySea. And I saw it. I was like, oh, fuck yeah, this is cool. But when I got there in the morning, it was like a 35 minute wait. And I was like, nah, I don't want to wait 35 minutes. So I got a fast pass for the Tower of Terror because I wanted to say that I'd been on the Tower of Terror in Tokyo because it's like my favorite ride. So then I went and I did like some other like little rides and that kind of stuff and saw a show that was in Japanese that I didn't realize. Like I ended up doing things that like I didn't even understand because they were all in Japanese and I didn't realize. And then by the time I'd done Tower of Terror, I was left with like a weird amount of time. And all the things I wanted to do were like well over an hour. And I was like, ah, I fucked this, haven't I? So I actually joined the queue for Midway Mania, realized what time it was, and was like, oh shit. I was like, I have to go because I forgot that I had to get out of the park, first of all, which is a long walk, then get on the little monorail to get back to the tram station to actually get on the metro. And then hope that there was a metro sometime soon so that I could get back to the main train station, like the big one, to meet Jer. So I was like, well, shit, I gotta go. So my biggest downfall was like not planning at all. But in my defense, I wasn't anywhere near as a Disney park nut then as I am now.
Yeah.
So I just never had the foresight. And I also, because there was part of me that also didn't want to look at vlogs because I wanted to be surprised myself as to what it was like. So it was kind of a catch 22.
Mm. Yeah, I get you.
You didn't do much planning on your single days, did you?
On mine? No, because I didn't realize there were going to be single days.
Yeah, yeah.
So the days that I kind of had like days by myself was on my trip to Florida. I kind of had a bit of a falling out with the person that I went with and just ended up in the park by myself. Now, what I will say about Disney is that like the, I suppose, kind of like main day that I was left to my own devices, my phone had died because I'd forgot to charge my brick charger. And so I was kind of just left in Magic Kingdom by myself. And I was like, cool. So I can't go on my phone. So I was like, cool. I'm just going to do all the things that the person that I was there with had refused to do. So I went and met Merida. I met Fishy Ariel. I went and met Gaston.
Fishy Ariel. As opposed to Mermaid Ariel.
She's always a mermaid.
Sorry, Siri is shouting to me. Yeah, Fishy Ariel.
She's a mermaid regardless of if she's in land or water. So, yeah. Fishy Ariel.
I would go mermaid human Ariel.
No, it's fishy or peasant.
Yeah, they're your options.
You learn something new.
Fishy or peasant.
And I went on Haunted Mansion loads and I basically just spitefully did all the things that they kept being like, no, I don't want to do that. And I was like, well, fuck you, I'm going to do it anyways. and went and got solo pictures in front of the castle because I was like, I don't want all of my castle pictures to include this person that I've had a falling out with. So that was all I did, basically. I went and did spiteful things.
things that I wanted to do.
Because I did really want to go meet Gaston. And I really wanted to go meet Merida because I don't even know if Merida still has that same meet and greet spot in, well, probably not right now, in Magic Kingdom. But like, it was real cute. There was like archery and like kids could like color in like pictures and draw their own bagpipes and stuff. It was real cute. Yeah, it was very cute.
Yeah.
Would you say that your experiences going solo were affected in any way by being a female? Like, do you feel like you at any point were like, man, if I was a man, this would be easier, or this experience would be different, or
it's just life as like,
well, yes, but like, was there anything you encountered where you were like, that's shit, or was there any bad, basically, was there any like negative experiences you had from traveling solo as a female? Or was everything dandelions and roses?
No, like, I have to say, I was going with a really, like, stupid and illogical but comforting logic that Disney wouldn't let me die. And so... I can see Kate being like, huh?
Well, so just like, I was kind of like... died on Disney property, so... No,
Disney will not let me die. And so I kind of was of the mindset that, like, once I got to Disney, kind of like Sandy was saying earlier, like, I'd know my way around, that would all be good. I was very much like the Dara O'Brien, just get it to Ireland, just get me to Disney, I'll know what to do from there. So the only part that like slightly concerned me was airport to Disney. And I will say I did have a moment where when I got to the like man with like my name on a board, as he took my bag and we got in the lift, he was like, you're on your own. And I was like, no, my friend's in the park. And I just kind of had that moment where I was like, maybe I shouldn't say I'm on my own, just in case. I'm sure nothing would have happened, but the question threw me. And I was
in reality, like, because I find that once they were for prestige, they're pretty good.
Yeah.
So like in reality,
if it was a regular taxi driver, I probably definitely wouldn't have. Again, I'm sure regular taxi drivers are like vetted and like, all that.
But I still wouldn't get, like, no offense to them, but I don't think I'd get in a regular taxi France.
Yeah.
Because you just don't know. Mm-hmm. And like, that's not against the French or anything. It's not. It's just well known with French taxis that they properly prey on tourists.
Yeah.
Like, I know that some Irish taxi men do. Like, they'll go like the long way around and stuff.
Yeah.
But it's still pretty, like, even if they go the long way around, you're still pretty much guaranteed to get to your destination without them kidnapping or trying to drug you.
Yeah.
And I just feel like they don't have that reputation in France whatsoever. It's like, it's 50-50. If you get in this taxi, you don't know what's going to happen.
Yeah. Yeah. So that was the only thing for me, is that I feel like if I was a man, I would have just answered yes.
Yes.
But other than that, no, that like everything was fine from there for me anyway.
What about you, Sandy?
No, like, I had no negative experiences as such, but I was very mindful, say, traveling from the airport to Disney, of my possessions and me and my surroundings a lot more than as if I was with somebody else, where I'd be a bit more relaxed. So I was very self-aware. My first solo trip, I stayed in Santa Fe, and the room they had put me in was like way back yonder. Like, I mean, they couldn't have picked the furthest room away. And I just did say, look, I'm here on my own. Is there any chance I could get a room closer to, you know, the walkway along the river? They were really accommodating. They were like, yeah, no problem. No hassle at all. And then my second trip on my own, I stayed at High Park. So I was off site. And that one, I got the train. So I didn't take any Disney transport. I just got the train and walked, because I kind of knew where it was going anyway. But because your man at the hotel, he was like, you're on your own. If you need anything, if you need anything at all, I can give you local taxi men's numbers if you're unsure about walking back from the park, the buses go at these times, if you need anything, here's the desk number. They were really, really nice, and I hadn't asked for any of that, like, so they were quite friendly.
That's good to
know. Just walked, though. Like, it's a really well lit, fairly safe walk. So I walked home every evening. It was fine. But yeah, no, good experience all round, to be fair.
I think the resounding thing from this is that even as women, once you get to Disney, you feel quite safe.
Yeah. Oh, 100%. And it reminds me of a conversation that I had with Sandy. So I have nothing but flight vouchers at the minute. I have flight vouchers for basically every airline you can fucking think of because of COVID. And one of the flight vouchers that I have is for Delta. So obviously I would want to use them to go to the States. And there's two places that I really want to go to in the States. One is California to go to Disneyland. And the other is to go to Massachusetts to go to Salem. And I'm kind of like, I'll quite happily do either as a solo, like I'll quite happily do a solo trip to the States. But if I'm going to go by myself to America, the only place I would feel safe going is Disney. Because I'm like, get me to the parks and I'll be fine. Because like cast members are great. Once you've been to a Disney park, you know how to navigate a Disney park because they're not that different. So it kind of has that like homey feel to it. So yeah, because I was kind of like, oh well, these are two places that I want to go, but I don't think I would feel comfortable going to, I mean, it's nothing against Salem, it's nothing against Massachusetts, but I know I would feel safe in Disney
because
everywhere else in America people can have guns, you can't have guns in the park, even just that element being taken away, it's like oh, yeah.
Yeah, I do think there is that like over, like that overarching thing within Disney parks where security does mean a lot to them and guest safety is a huge thing to them. Yeah. And it might not always come across to guests, but I feel like it is kind of always in the back of people's mind. They're like, oh, I'm not walking down just like a main street, or I'm not just walking down like Sixth Boulevard or whatever. Like I'm not like just walking down some blocks. Like I'm in Disney property. There is security everywhere. But that is the great thing about them is that you don't know that they're there, but you know that they're there. And so it doesn't inhibit your experience. And you're like, no one's going to jump me. Like the worst thing that's going to happen is maybe there's a pickpocketer, but even at that, probably pretty low. They won't have let anyone in who's of a danger. They're not going to let anyone in who looks sketchy because they just don't, they just it's blanket like no, like before they even get to the gates and stuff. So I do think that is one of the major positives about if you were to go on a solo trip, that Disney does offer that extra bubble of protection that makes it all just that little bit easier.
Yeah.
I feel like we're all groups of women who enjoy our own company as well. But like another thing with a Disney park is if you were thinking of traveling alone, if you felt anyway lonely, I mean, everyone there is in the same place for the same reason. Like you have people to talk to if you so wish, and you have a common ground to talk about.
Yeah.
And then I don't know about you, Sam, if you noticed it when you were in DLP on your own, but like people are so willing to take your photographs.
So willing.
So willing. When they notice you are on your own, it's like, hey, let me come in and help. I feel like cast members are more attentive. You get more time at meet and greets. You get treated a little better, I'm going to say, as a solo traveler. I mean, you just get more attention. So that is such a selling point for going on your own.
On the photos thing, I found one of my solo trips was just like on the cusp of the pandemic. And so cast members at certain meet and greets had started to refuse to take people's phones and to take pictures. So like I always have a photo pass anyway, but obviously not every character has a photo pass photographer.
That's DLP.
That's not less.
But like even at one point I was in a queue to meet Cowgirl Minnie, and I had gotten chatting to this family that was in front of me. And then someone came around throughout the queue and was like, do you have a pass? Cause it was like on my thing. They were like, we have slots for this. And I was like, oh, okay. I didn't even realize. And so they gave me a little slot and I went off and I had a cup of tea. And when I came back, that family had actually just gone. And the dad of the family came up to me and was like, they're actually, the cast members aren't taking photos, so we thought we'd hang around to make sure you got them. I'll take photos. And like waited an extra like 10 minutes with me just so that I could get, and like honestly took about 50 photos. Like he was getting angles. Wow. He was like I've always found, and like, don't be afraid to ask people as well as cast members, because I found that some of the best photos I've had, I remember after Illuminations one night, I wanted to get a picture, you know, with the castle on an empty main street. And there was this group of girls taking a few, and I was like, would anyone mind just taking a photo of me? And one of them girl was like, it's too dark, shine a light on her shnees, and like took out like her phone, and I had this like whole like studio lighting thing, and I was like mortified. Brilliant. But like so friendly, you know. Just return the favor, always return the favor.
Yeah,
that's the thing.
Good, and Disney karma.
Exactly, we always talk about the good Disney karma. And if you see like a couple trying to take like a selfie in front of the castle, I will always be that person that will run up and say, give me your camera, let me get a decent photo.
Don't
mean
to take one.
Yeah.
Because I remember, more often than not, they'll be like, oh, do you want us to take a picture? And you're like,
cool. Exactly. Yeah,
I think it's always mad, like, because like if I was, it's weird, so it's like if I wanted someone to take a picture of me, I'd want them to take a good picture. So if I'm taking a picture of someone else, I want to take a good picture. And so when people are like just standing there awkwardly, I'm like, pose, do something. I'm like, do a pose, yeah. Take your skirt out, yeah. Like, hug each other, do something pretty. I'll take it, do whatever you want.
I will happily stand here for 10 minutes and get perfect Insta shot. Like, go for it.
You do all the poses you want. I'm not here for like a quick snapshot. Like you like twirl, you like, you hug, you pose, you want singles, you want to swap out. Like, don't worry about it.
Yeah. And on the thing of like, being lonely, not once have I ever felt lonely in a solo trip, ever. I've actually had some of the best conversations with people as a result of being on my own, I think, because people are more like, oh, you're here alone. Like I've been in queues and been like chatting to families and stuff, and we've like added each other on Facebook, and then I've been like, oh, this person's around the corner, just FYI, you know, or like letting each other know about things.
That's
so.
The cork in you.
And you hear about Mary around the corner.
You know, or like I was in the queue for Aladdin, and there was a man behind me who was like, oh, I wonder where this thing is, and asked a cast member, and the cast member was like, oh, do I have a map? And I was like, I have a map, here you go. And then I was like, it's just here. And the cast member was like, just talk to her, and just walked away. I was like, where would you like to go?
Oh, DLP.
So like we've had, you know, and then I had a different family had gifted me some of their fast passes because they were leaving and because we struck up conversation. So because I'd been there loads and I knew that man didn't have long in the park, I like re-gifted the fast passes on, and then they bumped into me at the parade because I had told them where to sit, and they were like, oh, come sit with us, do you know. So like you just talk to people.
Yeah.
You know,
it's weird as well though, because like I feel like when you're in the park, you're an even nicer version of yourself. Like in day-to-day life, like if I see someone that needs something, I will probably go up and ask if they need help. Or if someone needs a hand getting off the bus or put a pram up some steps or something. Yeah. But like to general like public, I'm like, oh, I don't have time. Like, you piss me off sometimes.
You never know how they're going to react in general public though.
But it's like in Disney, it's like you want to know where to go. Like even if you overhear anything, anyone being any way confused, I'm like, hi, I can help. Where would you like to, I can do this. How, like, even if you don't speak the same language, it just sort of happens. Mm-hmm. You're like, yeah, I can do this. We'll figure it out. Don't worry. I'd rather you not waste your time when I probably know the answer.
Yeah.
Like that time we gave so we had like Golden Forest fast passes and we were giving them to a Spanish family. We didn't know they were Spanish, but it was a family of three. So we were looking for people of threes because that's what we had. Mm-hmm. And we ended up, we were like, hi, I think they were a bit taken aback, but we were like, here, and they were like, but then we found, so like they're the hotel fast passes, so they have it in all the languages, and we were like, Spanish, we're like, this bit, read that.
Yeah.
They were like, oh, they were like, thank you. We were like, no, bro.
Yeah.
So it is mad. It's like language just isn't a barrier in Disney, because this is gonna sound really corny, but like, even though Disney, we speak different languages, we all speak the same language. You know what I mean? That sounds corny as fuck.
A Disney nerd speak.
What am I, an ambassador? But it is kind of like that. Like, yeah, it has its negatives as Disney, but like, when you're in the park, it's just
it's a different vibe.
Yeah.
So I'm guessing the general consensus is that everyone, y'all recommend a solo trip.
1000%.
Oh yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
So obviously you recommend them. If you were to, I'm just going to round this off as maybe like one of the final-ish questions. Like, if you were to do a solo trip again, would you do anything differently? And also with that, do you have any tips for people who are doing or are thinking about solo trips when they can do so?
I think the only thing I'd do differently is be a little bit more confident with the restaurant choices. Because that's the one thing I feel like I've let myself down on, is I didn't really do too much character dining.
Do you eat? I was just at all.
In the morning.
Have you not seen Sam's snack packs that she brings?
So typically what I would do is so for example, taking my last trip, I would go to Starbucks in the morning, I would get a cup of tea and a cinnamon roll. I would meet Donald and then have a chat. About 11 o'clock, I dive into my snack pack, I have a cereal bar. Maybe at like one-ish I'll get like one of those like crepes or donuts or waffles, something from one of the snack kiosks. 5 o'clock, after the parade, 5:30-ish, I'd go to Pizzeria Bella Nota and get one of the little meals. And then I have some like popcorn illuminations, and that's me done.
Every day?
Yeah, more or less, yeah.
You'd eat in the same place every day?
I typically would eat in Pizzeria Bella Nota. I have eaten in other places, but I like that one because it's so close to the best spot for the parade. And then, you know, it's spaghetti and it's, you know, it's just, it all lines up perfectly.
Wow. Now I have to say, Sam, if we do go on a trip, we will
because when I go with, like, when I went with Mam, for example, we had like restaurants picked, like, you know, we had like Chez Remy, and I've been to Inventions and stuff, and I definitely wanted to go to those places. I was just a little bit uncomfortable at the thought of sitting in like a posh restaurant on my own. Now I think I would give it to my, I think I've been there on my own enough to know that no one is going to blink an eye at anyone sitting in a restaurant on their own. The amount of times I've seen like even just family split up and just be on their own, regard, you know, like, yeah, you never like, know.
Leave me alone.
yeah. So, you know, yeah. I don't think anyone would bat an eyelid at it. And I'd be fairly comfortable. That's the only thing I would do differently, I think, is include more character dining for myself.
And do you have any like top tips?
Top tips. Personally, I prefer to stay on site just because I find it's a whole bunch easier. So if you can, even in like the Santa Fe or anything, I would recommend that, because you can get all your shopping sent back to the hotel. You don't have to be worrying about carrying loads of stuff. It's real simple to just walk back. You don't have to worry about buses and stuff. But that's just laziness on my part and refusing to research different walks to the offsite hotels. Just be open. Like, be a bit of crack, you know, because I think if people see, the worst thing I've always seen is people who on their own who go up to characters and just stand next to them, because the character doesn't know that you're fun. If you go up like a screaming toddler, the character will interact with you way more. And you'll get better photos.
Like when you're the first person to meet Donald in the morning and you're like, oh my God, Donald, oh my God.
Yeah.
Because think, Donald has just woken up, he is at the same level as you. He's like, fuck yeah, beans. Let's go.
Just go with like a very open mindset in a sort of a, you know, just let yourself be a silly toddler, like release the inhibitions, and I guarantee you'll have an incredible time.
Absolutely.
That's great advice.
Sandy?
Hobbit, you, Sandy?
Yeah, like I wouldn't do anything different, because I mean, when I go on my own, I smashed it. Threw myself into it.
I am amazing.
Well, you're not wrong. But between staying on site and off site, like I've done both. I don't mind doing both. But as Sam said, like if you're going to do shopping, stay on site, because as someone on your own, you don't want to be carrying around bags. Send that shit back to your hotel. Like it's just handy. It's a breeze. I mean, don't do what I did and then buy too much and then have to leave half your clothes behind. But like,
oh, I just wear them all back.
Oh, I just leave them and then say I forgot them. They post them back. They will post them, so that's cool. And like any advice, again, just throw yourself into it. Like you will, like the most fun trips I have had, like not saying my trips with people, like they're different trips. They're still fun. They're great crack. But the trips that you have on your own are so different. They're so, because it's only you and you're just catering to what you want, they turn out to be the best trips because you've done everything you want to do. You've experienced everything you want to experience. If that is going on Big Thunder 17 times in a row, I mean, go for it. You know, you've no one there to answer to and it's fantastic. So I'd highly recommend it. Like you're missing out if you don't do a solo trip once.
Sold.
Same. See, my problem is, sorry.
Here we go.
I would love to do a solo trip, but I also enjoy people's, like people I like. Like I enjoy other people's company. Yeah, exactly.
You mean see.
So much. And I like feed off their energy.
Mm-hmm.
And like, I just love that so much. And I know I'd enjoy a solo trip, but I don't know if me as a person would enjoy a solo trip as much as being with someone who was on the same level as me. Do you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I think we've spoiled each other, and that sounds ridiculous.
I feel like you're because, so well matched though.
Yeah, because like if you wanted to feck off and go into studios and go on Tower of Terror, I'll quite happily get you fast pass and do literally anything else.
Yeah, do you know what I mean? But like
there's we'll never still, an issue.
But we'll still like join up afterwards again and then go watch the parade or go do this or go like get our perfect meal in oh my god.
Vapiano's?
Yeah, Vapiano's. I had a completely different name in my head for some reason.
Vapiano's.
Do you know what I mean? Not that I wouldn't enjoy a solo trip. I just don't know now that I've had those experiences being on the same level as the person I'm with, if not having that, I'd be like, like what I just sort of like shut down at points and be like,
Do you know what I would recommend for that actually? Because I suppose that's how I actually felt a little bit. And I have to say, I started just like posting shit on Instagram in like little vloggy snippets. And doing like live shows when I got back. Now I'm by no means like an influencer or a blogger or anything, but it just like helped fill that sort of like queue time where you would normally chat shit to your friend. You're like, so here's what I did with my day, McDonald's. Yeah. And you know, I found that was a nice way of still not feeling as isolated.
Yeah, I like that.
That's a good
so just become
tip.
An influencer.
Well,
and have oh, sorry, I'm coming up with loads of like tips now. just to bring it back. Conversation starters, like do something that like get into with cast members, like have pins that they can talk about, or like that you could even trade with them, or have like little pixie dust bags or something that you can give out. It's always a good like conversation. I love pixie dust. I think it's so much fun.
I'm gonna stop interjecting. I'm done.
I think we're done. Unless anybody else has anything else to add.
No.
I think we're good.
I would just like to get across my top tip for life. Don't be late to the airport.
Ever.
Ever. Regardless of where you're going. It's not worth it.
No. Not worth the stress.
I agree. I wholeheartedly agree.
So yeah. That's pretty much it for this week. Thanks so much to our special guests, Sandy and Sam. If you would like to special guest on Mickey Waffles, please DM us on Instagram at Mickey Waffles Pod. We are there and we are square.
Can I make a request for an episode?
Exactly. Go for it.
I would love to see an episode of you guys answering the frequently asked questions on Facebook pages like, does Sequoia Lodge have towels? And has anyone ever been to this restaurant of the 8 million people in a Facebook group? I would just, please, I would be very curious.
I will agree to that, but you have to pick the questions.
You have to get the questions.
Because we won't be able to do it.
Oh, can I host it? Can I like present it to you as absolutely. A real life?
Yeah.
I will research some.
Well, the thing is, if me or Sinead try to pick them, we'll be like, they're fucking stupid. We're not answering those. And we'll just like end up finding the ones that are actually relevant questions.
And you'll answer.
Oh, I love this idea, though.
The point of the episode.
Yeah, exactly. So you, as a separate third party, have to go away and find all these.
I've been giving myself homework. I wanted a funny episode.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, no, well I'm done. Care for that.
Fantastic.
Appreciate the content ideas.
No worries.
Fab. Well, thanks for listening, everybody. If you're listening on an iPhone or if your podcast app lets you leave reviews, please do. That would be great. We appreciate it. And there'll be links to Sandy and Sam's Instagrams and various other social media platforms and whatnot in the description box below.
And, you know, check out Christmas Crackers. We did Dolly Parton's Christmas on the Square this week.
Christmas on the Square.
If you'd like us to sing the entire musical for you, we will now. Once.
And on that note, good night and goodbye.